the book of Exodus, chapter 20. God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me. Amen. This is my text. Ani Adonai Elohecha, asher hotziticha, meretz Mitzrayim, mibet avadim. I am the Lord your God, and I am happy to speak about this just in a congregation of Jewish believers in Jesus. This video is made this morning, and it will be shown in Gentile churches. As you should know, I speak to a congregation of Jewish believers, but there are also many believers of the Gentiles. Those who don't know congregations of Jewish believers would wonder about that I wear this little hat, that I wear this mantle of prayer we Jews usually wear. That is a habit since thousands of years. God says, I am the Lord your God, who took you out of the land of Egypt. No, we have not been in the land of Egypt. He did not take us out. But I believe that every one of us can remember some great difficulty, some great sorrow, some great problems from which God took us out. Me, he has taken out from communist prison. Unexpectedly, I was sentenced to 25 years. And one day, they just came to the prison cell, you walk out. And when I was outside the gate, I stopped and I said with a loud voice, the wardens who were around heard this voice. I said, God, I thank you not so much for bringing me out of prison, but more for being with me in prison. And help me not to rejoice more about my liberation from jail than about the fact that you have been with me in jail all these years. And now I had to walk to the first bus, 4 miles. The prison Jilava is far, outside of town. And I could not walk. It has taken me ages to walk to the bus. And I look like Charlie Chaplin in rags. I was very thin. And I looked around. The world was so strange for me. During several years, I've been in solitary confinement, 30 feet beneath the earth. I had never seen sun, moon, stars, snow, flowers, birds, butterflies, none of these things. And now, at once, I was in such a world. I caressed the trees. I had not seen a tree. I bowed over flowers. I listened to the birds which chirped. I saw a strange being, a being with 4 legs. I, during the years of jail, have seen only beings with 2 legs. And now I saw one with 4 legs, I so wondered. It was a cow that I had not seen. And then I walked, I began to walk, and I saw one of the most beautiful beings on earth. I saw for the first time a lady. I had not seen a lady for 10 years. I had not seen a child for 10 years, and now I saw a lady. Ladies are really wonderful beings, and I would recommend husbands to treat them very, very well. I know how beautiful they are because I have not seen 14 years ladies. And that lady seeing me dressed like a beggar, everybody knew there is a jail, So she imagined I come from jail, and she called me, hey, come here. And she gave me a few coins. You should have this money for the bus. Now, I was not used that people should give me coins for the bus. And I said, I'm sorry, I can't take it. Take it for Christ's sake, she said. Well, if it's for Christ's sake, you can give even more. And slowly, slowly, I left the bus, and I arrived to my home. My wife was not there. She never told me where she had been, but she was not there. I found my two sons. When I left them, they were small. Now my son was as tall as me. One of my sons was as tall as me. And he asked me, Father, after all these years, what can you tell us? And I said to him, well, I've forgotten almost everything I ever read. Because during these 14 years in jail, we never had a book, neither the Bible nor any other book. We never had writing material. This world of books has disappeared forever. And I said, I have forgotten almost everything. We were very, very hungry in prison. There were times when we had one slice of bread a week, otherwise soup of potato peas. The communists were nice comrades. They ate the potatoes and gave us the peas. And cabbage with unwashed intestines and other such dainties. And we were very hungry. And there was something else. They doped us with drugs. In every cup of coffee, don't believe it was coffee, it was something black. And in every soup, don't believe it was a soup, it was something, it was called soup. But in every food, there were drugs to destroy our minds. We smelled the drugs, we knew they were there, but we had no choice. That was the only food which we could get. And because of this doping, and because of the hunger, and there were beatings and tortures, I will not describe them, we forgot more and more. And I forgot books which I have read. I forgot books which I had written. Then with the time, we forgot the Bible too. We tried to remember it. It was not possible to remember it. And I told my sons, whatever I have read, I have forgotten. But I repeated to myself again and again five things, which are the essence of my Bible, the anything which I know from the Bible really. First, there is a God, and He is our loving Father. Secondly, Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world and the lover of my soul. Thirdly, the Holy Spirit loves us and wishes to give us all the light which we need to arrive to heaven. For surely there is a beautiful heaven, and one must be an idiot not to go there when it is given to you for free. I am a Jew, and Jews know to appreciate something which is given to you. They have a good spirit. If anyone would offer me a bicycle, I would take it and I would say thank you. Now, one offers me heaven for free. And not to take it, somebody must be stupid. Why don't you take it? It has cost much. It has cost him, Jesus, his life. But to us it is given for free. And I told them there exists this beautiful heaven. And we should take it. Because there exists also a terrible hell. I know about this hell, not from sermons, not from the Bible. The Bible I did not remember. I know about hell because I've been there. There were times in prison when I looked during the night to the cup of water which I had in myself to convince myself that it is not hell yet. That was the only difference between hell and earth. There were times in the Romanian prison of Pitești during almost 3 years. Christians have been compelled day after day to eat their own outfall and to drink urine. By unspeakable tortures, they were compelled to do it. And the communists were not satisfied with this. On a Sunday morning, they compelled a Catholic priest, his name was Kerubian, whom they had maddened through tortures. This poor man did not know anymore what he does. He's not guilty. He's not guilty. But on a Sunday morning, they gave into his hands, in one hand, a plate, this human offal, and in another, a cup stolen from some church, this human urine, and he was put to say the mass over these elements. Now you know that in the Catholic mass, the same words are said, which are said probably also in your congregations, everywhere, in evangelical congregations, in the congregations of Jewish believers, everywhere. The holy words of Jesus, which angels shudder to pronounce, take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. And take and drink. This is my blood, shed for you. These holy words were said over human dirt and over urine. It was hell on earth. And I told my children, there is a heaven, and there is a hell. And you better enter in heaven and shun hell. And the fifth thing which I've learned in prison is that love is the best of it. You will never find something more lovable than love. Than love, love. And you should walk the ways of love. So I know what it means to get out of prison. Just as the Jews in Egypt, they were slaves, they were beaten, they were all kinds of things which a slave suffers. And one day they were free. And God said, I've taken you out of this. Me also he has taken out of such a thing. You might not have been in prison, you might not have been in such terrible circumstances, but every one of you has had his terrible days when everything seemed to crush everything. There was no hope anymore. And then from somewhere hope appeared. And things changed. And after the dark night came the light. It was God who took you out, who took you out from the bondage. But there is something else from which God took me out and took you out. It is terrible to think. During millions of years, there was a God, and there were angels, and then there was this universe, stars and galaxies and whatever you like, and then on this earth there were trees and beautiful flowers, roses and lilies, and beautiful children, and so much joy, and forests and brooks and mountains and the sea, and I was not there. He took me out of not being. I was not. There was no Richard Dolan. And he made it that a certain man should love a girl. And they loved each other, and they caressed each other. And then they came out. God made it. God made it. They could not make a child. But God made it. He brought me into being from non-being. How thankful we should be to this God. And how should we love him from all our heart? For the simple fact that we are. In the darkest day, we were in prison, we were. We existed. We were beaten, we were. We were hungry, we were. With life, with hope. He has given us this great boon of existing. There exists a good God who imparts life, and who imparts life not only for now. God made it that I should be in India. And I preach in India. Now, there they come. I preach in India. And there in India, not many, almost nobody comes to a Christian meeting in car, because they have no car. They have no bicycles. Many, many of them have no shoes. So they walk barefoot. And they walk miles. They are very poor. And they come to the service. But when you walk barefoot, somebody had a thorn entering in his foot, and he could not come in time. And when he, in the end, arrived to the meeting was just finished. He heard only the last blessing. And he came home happy and said to his wife, he says, it means so wonderful, my wife. Splendid. I'm sorry that you, because of the small children, could not come. It has been just splendid. What was the sermon about? I did not hear the sermon because I came late. What did they sing? I did not hear any song. All was finished when I came. So what is your happiness? What was so splendid? Well, I heard the last words of the pastor. He lifted his hands and said, the peace and the blessing of God will be with you forever. Do you understand why, what it means? Forever, 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 forever. What do I need the sermon? What do I need the song? We'll have life forever, forever. That is what he gives, our God. And therefore, we love him from all our hearts. And we wish to pass our eternity with him and not far from him. Now, how should we do it? There was a renowned Greek doctor. His name was Aeschylus. He said, who wishes to have a good sleep must prepare the good sleep from the morning. From the morning you should see your day should be quiet and you should think well, all these things. Because otherwise, in the evening, in the last 10 minutes now, I will quite, you will not have a good night. You have to prepare it from the morning. And who wishes to rest when he dies, he should rest. He should have his time with God. He must begin it already now. So many of you, I believe also, those who are here are immigrants in America. There are two kinds of immigrants. Some propose to themselves, I will go to America, so they learn the language. They learn something about the culture in America. They learn something, some trade which can be useful in America, and they come here and they find a job. Others learn nothing. Learn nothing. Don't prepare themselves, and they don't have. Some have heaven in America, others have hell because they did not prepare themselves. Now, how can we prepare ourselves for being there? Before Billy Graham, there was another Billy, you might have heard about him, Billy Sunday. He was a renowned preacher, but he did not have the facilities which Billy Graham has. He had a tent, and he traveled with his tent. And one day, he was in a town and had preached there. The next day, with his helpers, he gathered the tent to go to another town, and a young man came. Mr. Sunday, I was so sorry, I could not come yesterday to your service, because I worked the night in the factory. But please tell me, what can I do to be saved? What can I do to enter in heaven? Go away from here. Why did you not come yesterday? You can do just nothing. All the helpers were so wondered about him. What kind of a pastor is this who shouts like this to a man who says that he wishes to know the way of salvation? And this man, but can't you tell me, at least in a few words, go away, I have nothing to tell you. You can do nothing for your salvation. And this man left very sad. And the helpers were very puzzled. And when he had walked a few steps, Billy Sunday, not satisfied with what he had told him until then, shouted after him, sir, I tell you again, you can do nothing more for your salvation. Jesus has done everything. And that is it. We have a God who wishes me to be with him in heaven much more than I wish to be in heaven with him. He wishes to forgive my sins much more than I wish to have my sins forgiven. He longs after me. He is restless if he doesn't know that I'm on his side. And he should be all our Lord. He should be all our Lord. Joys are prepared for us which we can't describe here on earth. When I read first the New Testament, I wondered about the much joy which is in it. The New Testament is such a tragic book. The best of beings who has ever lived on earth has been whipped to the blood, crowned with a crown of thorns, spat upon, and crucified. So this book should not be a joyous book, no? And he had a predecessor, John the Baptist, had his head cut off. And then this question of apostles, they've been beaten. And then I knew they've been killed. And the whole book is so tragic, about suffering and suffering and suffering of the righteous. And the book is full with song. An angel comes to Zechariah and tells him, you will have a son and he will be a prophet. That was not good news, because he knew that the prophets in Israel have been killed. A mother would not like it if she would be told, you will have a child and he will be handicapped. No, you don't. And if you know about your child, he will be a prophet, you know, he will have a very difficult life and he might be killed. So Zechariah, getting such news, she began to sing. And the Virgin Mary, an archangel, came to her and said, you will give birth to the Messiah, to the Savior. Now she was Jewish. And she knew from the Jewish prophecies that this Messiah will be killed, will be rejected, will be whipped, will be crucified. Everything has been said beforehand. A mother would weep if she would be told beforehand, you will have a child. And the child will be a homeless, will be a beggar, will sit in jail. No mother would enjoy it to give birth to such a child, knowing beforehand his destiny. So Mary, when she knew that she will have such a child, she began to sing. And Jesus, on the last evening, he knew, he goes now to Gethsemane. He knew that there he will be betrayed by his friend, by his disciple, Judas. And that he will be handcuffed. And that all the troubles and the sufferings will follow. And it is written, he sang on that evening. And then we know that is not written in the Bible, but I can tell you. It was Passover evening. Next day, Jesus was crucified. It was Passover. And John's apostle took Virgin Mary to his home. And he was a faithful Jew. And I knew what he did on that evening. What my father did on that evening, on every Passover evening. And what the father of my wife did on such an evening. It was a Seder, if you know what it is about. Jews have a ritual in every home. In every home, every family has a ritual every Passover evening, and they sing certain songs which date, nobody knows since when. But perhaps 1,000 or 2,000 years before Christ. And the song is sung even now. There is one renowned song which surely John and Mary must have sung on that evening because they were Jews. Does that belong to a Jewish Passover evening? Some of you might know the song. The song is called Hadgadiah. It is sung by the Jews even now. And I will tell you the words of the song. That's so strange. Since thousands of years, Jews sing this every year and don't know what they sing. I will tell you the words of the song. I will tell you shorter, the song is longer. My father bought a kid, a little goat, bought a kid for 2 coins of silver. And a bad dog came and killed this kid. Then a man with a thick stick came and killed the dog, which killed the kid. And then a fire came and burnt the stick, where the dog has been killed. And then a big water came and quenched the fire, which had burned the stick, which had killed the dog, which had killed the kid. And then a cow came and drank the water, which had quenched the fire, which had burned the stick, which had killed the dog, which had bitten the kid. And then a butcher came and killed this cow. And then the angel of death came and took the life of the butcher, who had killed the cow, who had drank the water, who had quenched the fire, which had burned the stick, which had killed the dog, which had beaten to death the kid bought by my father for two coins. And this is sung since thousands of years by the Jews, and you ask them, what is this song about? They don't know. Mary knew when she sang this song. In this song, everyone gets a punishment for what he has done. One was completely innocent, the little kid in the beginning. That was her son, who has given his life for every one of us. And therefore she could sing, because she knew that after such a sacrificial death, there will be a resurrection in Russia. I just come from Russia. I've been now in Russia. In Russia, they've published a book called The Gospel According to the Computer. And they say, they say that in these big computers, you might know what these computers are. Don't ask me what computers are, I don't know. I'm 82, so I belong to another age. But these are calculating machines. They have them at the Pentagon and in banks, and they calculate all kinds of things. You put questions, and this calculates and gives you the answer. And they put the data of Jesus in the computer. There was a man whose life has been predicted hundreds and thousands of years before. And he was born in poverty and in oppression, lived his whole life in poverty and oppression, but was always good and loving and forgiving. He's made great miracles. And in the end, out of love, he took the sins of everybody upon himself, that the others might be forgiven, that they might have heaven. He took upon himself the sufferings of all others. And he died on the cross, saying his last words, "Father, in thy hands I surrender my spirit." Now you, computer, calculate. What happened to this man after his death? And the computer answered, "Death could not hold him." But David says, "No, this without a computer." So David knew mathematics better than a computer. So that is the way. We have a Romanian. I am from Romania. We have a Romanian with whom we can boast with him. He died as a martyr for Christ. He lived in a province of Romania which has been stolen by the Soviets, Bessarabia. And there they even Russified the names of the Romanians. They changed their names. His name in Romanian was Ion Moisiu. They made it Vania Moiseev. This man, Vania Moiseev, a young Romanian of perhaps 20, he was in the army. And in the army, he witnessed for his faith. He has the same faith which we have in Jesus, with a little difference. His faith was contagious. If I had the flu, somebody will catch it from me, in my family or in my job. If I've had the flu and nobody caught it from me, I can be sure it was not the flu, it was a simple cold, because the flu is contagious. And faith in Jesus is also contagious. If I've had this faith 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, nobody caught it from me, be sure it was not the right faith, because faith is contagious, no? It's contagious. And around him, soldiers and officers in the Red Army were converted. They persecuted him, they beat him, they made him to stand barefoot on the ice, in the snow there in Russia and so on. And they asked him to give up his faith and to give up singing, to give up. And he said, "But comrades, if you would make a law that nightingales are not allowed to sing, what would nightingales do the next day? They would sing, because no law can hinder them, and nobody can hinder me to sing and to speak about Jesus." Now, to cut the story short, they killed him. We have the picture of his corpse. They stuck him 6 times in the region of his heart. But while he was in the stockade, in prison, waiting to be killed, he succeeded to send out to his mother a slip of paper, a small letter, in which he says, "Mother, they torture me badly, but don't weep." He was young, he was 20, and believed that you can convince a mother not to weep. A mother, that belongs to the calling of a mother, to weep, even when it is needed. When it is not needed, a mother weeps. He asked her, "Mother, don't weep, because I have seen an angel, and the angel showed me heavenly Jerusalem. It is so beautiful a city, Mother, it is so gorgeous. I am happy to be there, and Mother, you do your best. And we should meet there too." Now, had he really seen an angel? Can somebody just see an angel like this? Did he really see an angel? In the end, if you will put me forcibly on the floor, will open my mouth forcibly, and will shed one or two bottles of vodka or brandy into my mouth, I will also begin to see all kinds of things, no? Or if I take some drugs, I will see all kinds of... There is hallucinations. How do we know that I've seen an angel? Because he describes the angel... He was a peasant boy, without any culture. He describes an angel as no doctor in theology could describe him. He says, Mother, angels are transparent. If you have an angel before you, and a man stands behind the angel, the fact that you see, the fact that the angel is before this man, does not hinder you to see that man. On the contrary, looking to that man through the angel, who is transparent, you see that man so beautiful, so handsome, entirely else. Mother, I can see my torturers as beautiful. As Saul, the persecutor and the killer, could become an apostle. And I see in all those who tortured and beat me a splendid possibility. Every ugly caterpillar is a potential butterfly. And so I can love them, they're beautiful in my eyes. He saw angels, he really has seen them, because there's nothing really material to be seen. They are transparent, but they change the world before you. Now, if there was ever somebody transparent, it was Jesus. He was so clean, so you have no words to describe him. You can't see him. None of us sees him. Perhaps exceptional. In exceptional circumstances, there have been Christians who have seen him. I don't speak from the time when he was on earth, but now. But I know that I've seen Jesus, but the fact that looking to men through Jesus, I see them otherwise. Everybody sees him as a crook, and as a tyrant, and as a madman, and as I don't know what. And I can see beauties in him. And have hopes in him, it means I've seen him through Jesus. And the whole world is changed for us. If we look to the world through Jesus, the soup of the wife becomes better. And you don't have to criticize it anymore. If you look to the soup through the angel, we sometimes just look to the soup, take a spoon, I told you I don't wish so much salt in the soup. Why did you put salt in the soup? And put Jesus between you and the soup. And my wife has done, you know, it's always the wives who make the mistakes. Husbands make no mistake. But put between you and your wife, Jesus. And she will be changed. She will become so beautiful. And by the way, husbands can also become handsome. And the whole world will change with you. Dr. Gergitzen, who I presented you, he's pastor of the biggest Baptist church in Europe. We can both visit. The biggest Baptist church in Europe is in Romania, in the town of Oradea, and he is the pastor of that church. And if I remember well, I preached in that church, and I said, I regret that I have not been in Romania when they judged our dictator Ceausescu, and they sentenced him to death and executed him. If I would have been in Romania, I would have taken his defense, because I can see the beauty in a persecutor like this. Everybody wondered, how in the world would you have defended Ceausescu? And I told them, I was in jail with an officer in the former police of capitalist times, and this man was sentenced to 20 years in jail. He was a very religious man, always he made the signs of the cross, and he bowed and he prayed to God and to Christ and to Virgin Mary and to a couple of other saints and so on, the whole time of religion. And during the war, Romania was on the side of Nazi Germany against the Soviets. And during the war, he arrested a boy of 15 who had spread secretly communist leaflets against our government and for the Soviets, which was a very big crime at that time. They arrested this boy. And he had before him a boy of 15, who had become an atheist, who had become a communist, who did not know anything about God. Instead of seating him and telling him, my dear, dear young boy, I will tell you a better way than yours. I will tell you about God, about Christ. He has beaten him to the pulp. And with every lash he gave him, he convinced him there is no God and communism is the right thing. The name of that boy is Nicolae Ceaușescu. So we can't condemn only Nicolae Ceaușescu without asking ourselves, is there no guilt in us that somebody else becomes a torturer? Did we not neglect a duty of ours? When I was in a cell once, they pushed in a new prisoner. It was a priest. And they had beaten him. Blood was streaming. And we washed him a little bit. We gave him water to drink. And they asked him, Father, can you say the prayer, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they do. He said, I can't say this prayer. Jesus said it. My prayer is, Father, forgive me and them. Because if I would have been a better priest, he would not have been so bad a torturer. So it is somehow, when you look through Jesus to me, you have more understanding. Love understands everything, covers everything, has the capacity to forgive everything. The whole life is changed. And you live in a beautiful life. I can't tell you. Some have said that I'm a propagandist of communism because I describe life even in communist prisons was beautiful. But it was beautiful. I've heard you singing, and I heard your pastor when he, your rabbi, when he blessed this child, how he repeated a verse from the Psalms. This is the day which the Lord has made. We should rejoice and be glad in it. Zeh yom asher asah Adonai lingilu u'simcha bo. Now, it's interesting. The Psalm 118 was sung by Jesus on the last evening before going to Gethsemane, because it was Easter, Passover, and that belonged to the ritual of Passover. That is what Jews had to sing on that evening. And when he went to crucifixion, that was his song. This is the day which the Lord has made. What for? To rejoice and be glad in it. In prison, we sang every day. When I came to America, I found a strange kind of birds which sing only once a week. Nightingales and larks sing every day, but there are Christians and they sing only once a week. Only once a week. We in prison, we sang every day. And we sang being accompanied by musical instruments. The communists have been very nice to us. They knew that Christians and Jewish believers usually call themselves Messianic Jews. They avoid the word Christians, but we have the same faith. And we also sang with musical instruments in prison. The communists have been very nice to us. They knew we like it to praise God with musical instruments. And therefore, they could not give us violins or mandolins. It would have been too big an expense for the communist government. But they put chains at our hands and at our feet. And we discovered that chains are splendid musical instruments. And we could sing the day, clink-clang, clink-clang. The day, clink-clang, clink-clang, which the Lord has made, clink-clang, clink-clang, which the Lord has made, clink-clang, clink-clang. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. If you would ask me what our faith is, it is something which changes fairy tales in reality. When I was young, I also sought happiness. I read fairy tales. There was not this happiness. There was nowhere. I've had a very unhappy childhood and a very unhappy youth. And I did not believe that happiness exists somewhere. But this fairy tale has been changed in reality. Some of you might have very difficult life. Some of you might be very poor from American standards. If you would ask in Bangladesh or in India, there exists no poor American, a homeless American, one who lives on Social Security or I don't know what, and poverty is very rich there. If you are interested to know, a Romanian pastor who has a salary of $50 a month is very well to do. A Romanian pastor is very well to do. And in India, $30 a month and so on. But we can have our great difficulties, but we have God. We have Jesus, we have the Holy Spirit, and we are. He has taken us from non-existence. And he has made us to be forever and ever and has given us a life full of joy, even in those circumstances. I speak to you from experience. I am a man who have suffered much in life. Almost our whole family has been killed in the Holocaust. We know what it means to lose your whole family. Not to have family anymore. Gone. And so many other things. I've been not only communist prisoners, I've known much suffering in life, and I know very much suffering even in America. You can suffer very much in America too. But there exists this joy, this new life, which Jesus gives in the name of God. And I recommend to every one of you not to leave this hall without having Jesus as your bridegroom. You might have believed in him, you might have been somehow a believer, you might leave it, believer. To have him as your bridegroom, to have him in your embrace. Have him in your embrace. Usually they tell you, if you wish to know about God and so, and to know how you to solve your problems, here you read the Bible. It's a Bible, it's a book with 1,200 pages. You wish to solve your problems and you read the whole Bible, you don't even find the word problem in the Bible. And you don't find the word solution in the Bible. You are told it gives you a new character. The word character does not exist in the Bible. It will fill you with new sentiment. The word sentiment does not exist in the Bible. The Hebrew language was so poor. Only 6,500 words, the biblical Hebrew. English has 300,000 words. In the last 10 years, now there is a new edition of Webster's Dictionary of the English language. In the last 10 years, 20,000 new words have been added to the English language. And Hebrew has only 6,500. Now, why in the world did God choose such a poor language to give his revelation? Why did he not take the Latin language, the Greek language, which was much more advanced? The Greek of the New Testament is not advanced. It is the slang. It is the manner of speech of the low people, not the cultured. Why did God choose the Hebrew language? Because he wished our religion, our faith, should not be talk and words and words. It should be something entirely else. It should be life and joy and song. The Bible is very useful. I also study it every day. We should. But it is a book which shows us to a living being, to Jesus the Savior, and you should know him, and you should be with him. May I tell you one word from the Greek New Testament? In the Greek New Testament, you will find the word proskuneo. Proskuneo is the word for worship in the Greek language. It is also the word for kiss. Where it is written in the New Testament in Greek, you should worship God in spirit and in truth. In Greek it is, you should kiss him. Did you ever think about kissing him? But did you not read Psalm 2? How does it finish? Kiss the Son. Which Son? Jesus, no? No, you all believe in the Bible and wish to fulfill it. There it is written, kiss the Son. How many of you have ever kissed him? Why don't you kiss him? It's written there, you should kiss him. The bride in the Song of Solomon says, let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. Why don't you wish his kiss? Jesus enters in the house of Simon the Pharisee. He has been invited to a dinner. You can be sure there were all kind of appetizers and all kind of meats and soups and pies and everything, and fruits was there on the table, and there were flowers and there was wine and there was everything. And Jesus looked to all these things and said, I have entered into your house, Simon, and you did not give me. What did I not give? I told the maid to put everything on the table. What is missing? I entered in your house, and you did not give me the one thing after which I long, a kiss. Why don't you give me a kiss? Well, we all are somehow faithful. Somehow we are believers. We would not be here otherwise. But are you one who gets kisses from Jesus and gives kisses? Well, when he was on earth, it was easy to kiss him. His mother must have kissed him thousands of times, like every mother. Joseph must have kissed, and so many. It was the habit among the Jews at that time to kiss each other when they meet. Even Judas kissed him. So, but now, when he's not here, bodily, how can I kiss him? Well, my wife got more kisses from me when I was in jail than now. Now, when I wish to kiss her, the telephone rings. Another time, I wish to kiss her and have to run to some meeting and so on and so on. But in prison, I did not have any of these things. And I could really kiss her. Kissing is not only the approaching of two pairs of lips, but it is a melting in love of two souls, no? Of two souls, forever. And this should be our connection with Jesus, and through him with God the Father and with the Holy Spirit. It is a life of joy. I'm 82. I never know. I've had already three heart attacks. I don't know when I will have the fourth. I don't know when I start the sermon. I don't know if I will finish it. And I try always to give the best. And I wish that you should love God, but really from all your heart. And it should be like a wedding feast, like a wedding feast. That is what our faith gives the possibility of, such a wedding feast. That is what I had to tell you. We have gathered here in these good conditions. Not everywhere believers can gather like this. I work in a mission called Christian Mission to the Communist World, a mission which helps the persecuted Christians, not only in communist countries, we help also in Muslim countries. Not everybody can worship God like you. In Sudan? No, in Sudan. They cut off the arms of Christians and used the arms for beating the drums. In Iran, believers have been stripped naked and buried in the snow until they froze. And good Saddam Hussein, our friend in Iraq, has killed 5,000 Christians, many of them with poisonous gas. And so on and so on. In Red China, we received the news only this week. Our brother, one of our brethren, has been hung head down and left to die like this. Hung head down. He died like this. We have brethren and sisters like this. And they know that it is a path of suffering. Jesus has gone the way of the cross. And we must also be ready to walk the way of the cross. But this way is a beautiful way. When we were in prison, we never greeted each other with good morning or good evening. When we rose in the morning, there was somebody else near us. We would tell him, "May roses blossom on your cross." And he answered, "And on your cross too. Amen." That was our greeting which we gave. And there are heavy crosses, but roses can blossom on the crosses. And on you also have crosses. Some of you I know. You can be free, not in prison. You can be in America. You can have dollars in your pocket. You can have money in the bank. And there is some great sorrow. There is so much sorrow. There are these heavy crosses. And when you share the cross of Jesus, when you share also his joys, then roses begin to blossom on this cross. You are a changed man. When a pastor gives a blessing in the Christian church, or when the Jews, the priests of the Jews, give the blessing, they say in the synagogue, "May God shine his face upon you." And when a reflector shines his face upon you, then your face begins to shine. And God's face shines upon you, and you are a transformed man. I've known such men. Our mission works at this, of helping these persecuted. But we learn from them more, and we are helped by them more than we can help them. I met just now in Russia Brother Viktor Belikh. This is a film. Brother Viktor Belikh. He has been 24 years in jail in Russia, out of which 20 years alone in a cell. No family, no correspondence, not seeing his wife, mother, nobody, no nothing. 20 years alone in a cell. That's all. 7 hours at night, they would put a mattress of straw and he could sleep. And the other 17 hours, he was not allowed to lie down even on the cold concrete of the cell. He was not allowed to sit on the concrete. He was not allowed to stand on the concrete. The buttons were 52 to do. 17 hours a day it was managed, running around the cell. He had to run continually, and through a hole in the door of the cell, the wardens surveyed, and if he fell down or stopped, they would come and beat him 17 hours a day, 20 years! Like this. It's terrible. I have been in solitary confinement, but I've been only 3 years. Can't compare. I did not dare to lift my eyes towards such a man. And after 20 years, they sent him to Kolyma, to the north of Siberia, where the ice never melts. And I asked him, dear brother, but how can you, could you bear it after the first 20 years of such suffering to have another 4 years there in the court? And he answered, singing. Singing! Can you sing when your husband yells at you? As I'm 82, and I'm in many houses, wives would open their hearts and one would tell where my husband yells at me. And do you sing when he yells? How can I sing when he yells? That would make a very nice harmony. You make boo 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 boo, and you tra la 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 la, boo 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 boo, tra la 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 la. That's just fine. That is what Mozart did. That's what Bach did. That is a melody. This is a contrast. Can you sing? What if he beats me? Can you sing when he beats me? He replied, singing after 20 years in the solitary cell and 4 years in Kolyma. I asked him, how could you bear the cold there? And he said, with the fire of love burning in my heart, I made the eternal ice to melt. That is what love can do. Isn't that amazing? This victory. We have a faith which brings to victory. We have a God, as it is written in the verse which I told you, I am the Lord, your God, your God. He's your own, your God. You know, when I look to all the heavens and all to the gardens and all this, I just say, that's my real estate. It belongs to me. No, it belongs to my Father. I am your God. I am the God, your God, who is taking you out from sadness, out from hell. Many of us have been saved from hell through the blood of Christ. We will not go in the eternal hell. But we have a hell in our hearts. There's still hatred, and there is still strife, and there is I don't know what, all kind of. He saves us from all hell and puts a song on our lips. And we should know Jesus in this sense. If you allow me just 2 minutes more, I promise it will not be more than 2 minutes. I can't promise that every minute will be just 60 seconds, but it will be 2 minutes. It will be 2 minutes. There's one very strange word said by Jesus. Now, Jesus is God. And he says that at the last judgment, some will appear before him, and he will tell them, go away from me, I never knew you. But this is a great shame for a God not to know his creature. What kind of a God is he if he doesn't know somebody? He has said that God knows even a little bird, a sparrow. He knows it. And he will tell men, I don't know you. How can he say? It's downgrading for a God, no? To say, I did not know you. This is just I finish you because you will, perhaps you will not have the occasion to hear this from somewhere else. The word to know in Hebrew, yada, and in Greek, gnosis, means sexual union. The Bible says, Adam knew Eve, and the child was born. Yada, to know, is the same word as to have sexual union. The same word. And Jesus knew these men, in the sense that I know many men. Ah, yeah. I shook hands with him once. He told me, hello, hello. I know many men, no? But there are a few whom I know, really, who have been near to me. And we all know Christ. But we are meant to know him in an entirely other sense. We should know him as a bride knows the bridegroom who embraces her and kisses her. We should know him, we should become one. Just like in a wedding. A believer, Artemudia, in Russia, has been killed. and one of his prison comrades said that once we discussed, in prison you have time to discuss, and I asked him, are you married, man? When did you love your wife more, before the marriage or after? And he replied, well, before the marriage, I loved her very, very much. After the marriage, to tell you the truth, I can't tell you that I loved her because there was no more me and she, we were one. There was no end to me and she should begin. We were just one heart. We were one soul. There was not somebody else to love. And that it means to mean Jesus. To be so united with him. He lives in me, I live in him. We live in his embraces. We worship him really. We receive his kiss and give his kiss. That is what I had to tell you. And with this I have finished.